Hello and welcome. This is Pastor Ken Ortiz, and we're continuing in our study of the pastoral epistles. We've begun in 1 Timothy, and we've made our way all the way to chapter 4, verse 13. So if you'd like to join me there as I begin by reading this opening passage that Paul gives to us here, where he's writing to Timothy, essentially describing to him how he is to fulfill his roles and responsibilities as the leader of the Church of Ephesus. He had many challenges, not only because it was a largely pagan, idolatrous culture. In fact, the center of the worship of Artemis, one of the favored gods of the Greek people at that time, was right there in Ephesus, and it was quite a challenge to maintain your faith and your purity in the midst of a culture which really, you might say, militarized against that, as we see with Paul almost being killed there by the crowds as well. But he says to Timothy, he says in verse 13, "Until I come, devote yourself to the reading of Scripture, to preaching and to teaching." Now, I want to begin by looking at this one word where he says, "Devote yourself." Even though it's, you know, getting towards the end of the month of April, I have to say that May and June are very special months in my life, because they mark probably the two most definitive events that I have made on my behalf. We might say that your birth is the most definitive moment of your life, and your death is the last most definitive event of your life. But the ones that I made choices for, I don't choose the day of my death, and I don't choose the day of my birth, but I can make choices on what I choose to devote myself to at various junctures in my life on this planet. And the first one that really stands out was May 29th, 1969. Now, the fact that I remember that date is significant to me, because I can't think of any other reason why I would remember that day, and even why I remember that day, except that was the day in which I gave my life to Jesus Christ. That was the day in which I bowed the knee and I asked Jesus to come into my heart. And the fact that I've remembered that day, I mean, it's so emblazoned on my mind, I cannot forget it, tells me that it was more than just the date of the calendar. It was the significance of those events that made that date memorable. And what I did on that day was I not only asked Christ in my heart, but I devoted my life from that point forward to being a follower of Jesus Christ. And the second date that's real significant to me was June 14th, 1970, a little more than a year later, when my wife and I pronounced the vows of marriage, and I promised God on June 14th, 1970, that I would love, protect, and provide care for my wife until death separated us in this life. And that was something that I made a vow to be devoted to her as my one sole companion in marriage for the rest of my life. And the thing is that as I look back on my life, I realize that what really has made my Christian life successful, not flawless certainly, but successful and largely effective, is the fact that I went into it with a sense of complete devotion. And the same thing with my marriage. When I married my wife, I devoted myself until death do us part. And so those two institutions, or those two events, I should say, in my life have really kind of informed all of the other decisions that I've made thereafter. And in the same way that we know that a tree, the roots of a tree are devoted to the trunk, and the trunk is devoted to the branches, and the branches are devoted to the fruit, and we can tell by the fruitfulness of the tree how devoted all those parts are one to another. Are they devoted in the right sequence, so that when we see something like fruitlessness in a tree or withering fruit, we know that there's something wrong someplace? It can be limited to just a branch that we see is broken off or injured, and we would take that one off and allow the tree to continue to be fruitful. Or we cannot treat that and let it begin to affect really the trunk itself and eventually reach to the roots and bring an end to the tree and bring an end to its fruitfulness. What I'm saying is that there's an interconnectedness to the events of our life and the circumstances we find ourselves living in based upon previous things that we chose to devote ourselves to. So when I see people who don't continue in their faith after asking Christ into their heart and they get caught up in all sorts of things and misdirections, I realize that there became a question, I would say a question to the depth of their devotion. They had other options. It was kind of like me saying, well, I'm going to give my life to Christ and I'll see how it goes. But if it doesn't work out right, then maybe I'll move back to Hinduism, or maybe I'll move on to something else, or just move into basic paganism, which is defined by a secular culture. I say all of that because really it's that double-mindedness that James warned about. It's that loss of the first love that Jesus warned about in Revelation chapter 2 that becomes the real problem, that if we stay devoted to Christ in all terms and circumstances, in other words, every decision we make is predicated on the fact that there's a previous devotion to live and to follow and honor Christ, or as Paul said in Ephesians 4, to walk worthy of the calling. And not that I ever look at myself as being worthy, but I want to live and pursue a goal of worthiness, to live up to his requirements, his expectations, both his precepts and principles. That becomes something that you devote your life to and say, this is what I want to be, the thing that defines most about my life. And the secondary issue is that I want to be defined as a man who is faithful to his wife. And so these things really do inform your choices. So whether to be unfaithful to my wife or to divorce or any of those things has never been a serious consideration. I would be lying if I say that thoughts don't pass through your brain at various times. But it's never been a serious consideration because I've made an act of devotion based upon a previous act of devotion. A devotion for Christ may have resulted in a devotion to my wife at marriage. And everything that follows after it, and I think about here, I am in just about in my 40th year, beginning my 41st year as pastoring this church. And why am I still pastoring here? It hasn't always been easy, hasn't even been fun. Sometimes it's been downright difficult. And the easier path was to choose another path. And yet, at the end of the day, I came back and realized, because I had devoted myself to Christ, I had also devoted myself to serving this group of people in this congregation. And I would be dishonest if I didn't tell you that through the years there haven't been other opportunities that were less challenging or at least seemed more financially lucrative and beneficial. And yet, when my wife and I prayed about them, you know, we really realized, no, it's really not God's will for our life. And so being where God planted us and continuing there has been essential to really how we've lived our life. And that's why when Paul says to Timothy, you need to devote yourself to certain things. And in this case, he said the reading of Scripture, the preaching and the teaching of the Word of God, that you realize that Paul is saying that it's only if you devote yourself to these things that you'll see the benefit. Because what I find is that even the word in the original means to hold to cleave to a thing. It even uses, in some context, refers to being addicted to it. And the idea is that you give every thought and every effort is ultimately related to that thing that you're focusing on, that you're devoting upon. And it means that, as a consequence, that you give all or large amounts of your time. I mean, I would simply say that my relationship with Christ is not something that I can allow to go unattended. That it's almost like it's my garden that I have to continually be weeding if I want to continue to be fruitful, you know, illustrating the parable of the sower, where he says that some Christians get choked off and become unfruitful. Why? Because weeds have grown up and literally suffocated the spiritual growth. And I've seen that happen, and I felt that happening in my life at various times where I started getting caught up in other things and started neglecting the idea of spending time with God every day, devoting myself to his word every single day. Then I began to realize you start giving yourself permission to be lax. You know, you don't run off hog wild and live a crazy, wanton life. But the whole point is you just aren't giving the same attention and consideration and concern. And so when Paul used this, he's saying, you know, that followers of Christ, We cannot look at our relationship with Him as being a part-time effort. We can't say that we're multitasking, you know, that we give divide our affection, if you will, our devotion between our careers and our life in Christ. You can't do that. You have to make that following Christ is the central thing. And it's that issue, you know, sometimes between quality time and quantity time. Some people say, well, I don't have a quantity of time, but I give a quality time. And something I would argue, and I think it's a pretty sound argument, that you cannot ever achieve quality without at some point pouring in a quantity of effort. So, you know, when I have people say to me, well, I appreciate the message and I can see that you did a lot of research, I often think to myself, you have no idea how much time and effort goes into even preparing something like this. That this is the result of a lot of time spent thinking and processing and really studying and reading to really understand what is it that God is saying in His Word, and how does He want me to communicate that to you in these kind of podcasts or broadcasts? Well, we're way out of time, but we'll continue as we look again at what Paul means by reading of Scripture and preaching and teaching the Word of God.